when you care enough to send the very best, presents the Hallmark Hall of Fame. Tonight, the international film favorite, Dirk Bogarde. Broadway's sparkling new leading lady, Rosemary Harris. England's vivacious Rachel Roberts in her American debut. And the incomparable Ruth Gordon. In Blithe Spirit, Noel Coward's bewitching comedy about a man with two wives, one of them out of this world. Adapted for television by Robert Hartung. Produced and directed by George Schaefer. On the Hallmark Hall of Fame.
I see you managed to get the ice out of those little tin trays.
Yes.
I had a bit of struggle, though, but it's all right. And you filled the little trays up again with water?
Yes.
Very good, Edith. You're making giant strides.
Oh, and Edith, when you're serving dinner, try to remember to do it calmly and methodically.
Yes, sir.
As you're not in the Navy, it's unnecessary to do everything at the double.
Very good, ma'am.
Now go and get the extra glasses.
Yes, ma'am.
Not at a run, Edith.
Yes,
ma'am. No sign of the advancing hordes?
Not yet. I've been trying to discourage Edith from being quite so fleet of foot. You mustn't mind if everything's a little slow motion tonight.
You should rather welcome it. The last few days have been extremely agitating. What do you think induced Agnes to leave us and go and get married?
The reason was becoming increasingly obvious, dear.
You must keep Edith in the house more.
Oh, dear.
What's the matter?
I have a feeling this evening's going to be awful.
Probably funny, but not awful.
But why the Bradmans, darling? He's as skeptical as we are.
I've warned him he's got to behave himself, and there must be more than three people present. Two, the unseen.
I must say, that is a wonderful title.
Well, if this evening's a success, I shall start the first draft tomorrow.
Extraordinary it is.
What is?
Well, I don't know, being in right at the beginning of something. It gives one such an odd feeling. Hey, darling, it's most awfully strong.
Never mind.
All right.
Move.
Was Elvira a help to you? When you were thinking something out, I mean.
Yes, now and then. When she concentrated. But she didn't concentrate very often.
I wish I'd known her.
I wonder if you'd have liked her.
Oh, I'm sure I should. As you talk of her, she sounds enchanting. Yes, I'm sure I should have liked her, because, you know, never for an instant have I ever felt in the least jealous of her, and that's a good sign.
Poor Elvira.
Does it still hurt when you think of her?
Oh, no. I feel... You know, I wish it did, because I really did feel rather guilty.
Wonder if I died before you'd grown tired of me, if you'd forget me so soon.
Horrible thing to say.
No, I think it's interesting.
Well, for one thing, I haven't forgotten Elvira at all. I remember her quite distinctly. I remember how fascinating she was and her madness. I remember her physical attractiveness, which was tremendous, and her spiritual integrity, which was nil.
You can't remember something that was nil.
I remember how morally untidy she was.
Is she more physically attractive than I am?
That's a very tiresome question, dear, and fully deserves the wrong answer.
You really are.
Well, thank you.
A little naive, too.
Oh, why?
Because you imagine that I mind about Elvira being more physically attractive than I am.
I love you, my love.
Oh, I know you do. But not the wildest stretch of imagination could describe it as the first fine, careless rapture.
Would you like it to be?
Good heavens, no. We're neither of us adolescent, Charles. We've both been married before. Careless rapture at this stage would be incongruous and embarrassing.
I hope I haven't been in any way a disappointment, dear.
Oh, don't be idiotic.
Well, after all, your first husband was considerably older than you, wasn't he? I should hate to feel you'd missed out all along the line.
There are moments, Charles, when you go too far.
That's exactly what Elvira used to say.
Oh, not at all surprised. I never imagined, physically triumphant though she was, that she was entirely lacking in perception.
Darling Ruth.
Oh, there you go again.
As I think I mentioned before, I love you, my love.
Poor Elvira.
I was devoted to her. We were married for 5 years. She died. I missed her very much. That was 7 years ago. And now I, with your help, my love, have risen above the entire thing. Probably the Bradmans. Shall I go and answer it? Or should we let Edith have her fling? Perhaps she's in here.
Oh, she's probably on one knee in a frieze printing position, waiting for Cook to open the kitchen door.
Edith, steady, steady, steady.
Yes. Good evening.
Thank you.
Ah.
Good evening, Mrs. Cumberland.
Good evening.
Hello, Charles.
How are you?
We're not late, are we? We got back from the hospital about half an hour ago.
No, madam, my party hasn't arrived.
Ah,
yet.
That must have been her on the bicycle we brought coming up the hill. I said I thought it was.
Oh, then she won't be long.
I'm glad you were able to come.
We've been looking forward to it. I feel really quite excited.
I guarantee that Violet will be good. I made her promise.
There wasn't any need. I'm absolutely thrilled. I've only met Madame Arcati two or three times in the village. I mean, I've never seen her do anything at all peculiar, if you know what I mean.
A dry martini?
Mm.
By all means.
She certainly is a very strange lady. You know, it was only a chance remark of the vicar's that made me realize that she was psychic at all. Then I began to make inquiries. Apparently, she's been a professional medium in London for some years.
Do you think there's anything really genuine about it at all?
No, I suspect the worst. That's what I'm hoping for, anyway.
The chief character that I'm planning for in my book's got to be a complete charlatan. That is one of the most important facets of the whole story.
Well, what exactly are you hoping to get from her?
Oh, jargon, principally. You know, tricks of the trade. I haven't been to a seance for years. I want to refresh my memory.
Do you think she told fortunes? I love having my fortune told.
Now, look here, we've got to take this all very seriously, you know. We've got to pretend that we believe implicitly, otherwise she will not play.
I always understood that she was an authoress.
Here she is. I lean my bike up against that little bush. It'll be perfectly all right if no one touches it.
How nice of you to have come all this way.
Mrs. Condamine. Good evening, Miss Condamine.
My dear Madame Arcati.
Well, I'm afraid I'm rather late, but I had a sudden presentiment I was going to have a puncture. So I went back to fetch my pump, and of course it didn't have a puncture at all.
Perhaps you will on the way home.
Do you know the Bradman?
Dr. Bradman, the man with a gentle hand.
I'm delighted to see you looking so well. This is my wife.
We're old friends. We meet coming out of shop.
Would you like a cocktail?
Yes, if it's a dry martini. If it's a concoction, no. Experience has taught me to be very wary of concoctions.
It's a dry martini.
How delicious. It was wonderful. Cycling through the woods this evening, I was deafened with bird song. Oh, thank you. Cheers.
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 Don't you find it very tiring, bicycling everywhere?
Well, on the contrary, it stimulates me. I was getting far too sedentary in London.
I must say, I find bicycling very exhausting.
Oh, no. Steady rhythm, that's what counts. Once you get the knack of it, you need never look back. On you get and away you go.
But the hills, Lattenberg.
Down with your head, up with your heart. You're over the top like a flash. Skimming down the other side like a dragonfly. This is the best dry martini I've had for years.
Would you like another?
Certainly. Well, you know, you must be a very clever man. Anybody can write books. But it takes an artist to make a dry martini that's dry enough.
Are you writing anything nowadays, Madame Arcati?
Every morning, regular as clockwork, 7 to 1.
What is it, a novel or memoir?
No, it's a book for the children. Yes, I shall have to finish it by the end of October to catch the Christmas sales. It's mostly about very small animals. The hero is a moss beetle.
When did you discover that you had these extraordinary powers, Madame Arcati?
When I was quite tiny, my mother was a medium before me, you know, so I had every opportunity of starting on the ground floor, as you might say. I had my first trance when I was 4 years old, and my first ectoplasmic manifestation when I was 5 and a half. What a thrilling day that was. I shall never forget it. Of course, the manifestation itself was quite small, very short duration, but for a child of my 10 years, most gratifying.
Your mother must have been so pleased.
She was.
But do you always have a child as a control?
Yes, they're generally the best. Some mediums, of course, prefer Indians, but I personally find them very unreliable. Children get to know and understand your ways. Daphne worked with me for years.
Well now, Madame Arcati, the time is drawing near.
Well, who knows? It may be receding.
How very true.
I hope you feel in the mood, Madame Arcati.
Oh, well, it's not a question of mood. It's a question of concentration.
You must forgive us being so impatient. We can perfectly easily wait, though, if you're not quite ready to start.
Oh, Oh, nonsense, my dear. Oh, I'm absolutely ready. And now, hi-ho, hi-ho, to work we go.
Is there anything you'd like us to do?
Do?
Yes, like, holding hands or anything.
Oh, all that'll come later. First, a few deep, deep breaths of fresh air. You may talk if you wish. Won't disturb me in the least. That cuckoo sounds very angry.
I beg your pardon?
I said that cuckoo sounds very angry. Listen.
How can you tell?
Timbre. No moon. That's a good thing at any rate. Good night, you foolish bird. Table.
Yes, we thought this one might do.
Splendid. Well. Well, this is a moment that I hate. Little Tommy Tucker sings for supper. What shall he have with brown bread and butter? I despise that. It doesn't rhyme at all. But Daphne loves it.
Who's Daphne?
Daphne is Madame Arcati's control. She's a little girl.
Oh, I see. And how old is she?
Rising 7 when she died.
And when was that?
February 6, 1884. Poor little thing.
She must be a bit long in the tooth by now, I should think.
You should think, Dr. Bradman, but I fear you don't, at least not profoundly enough.
Don't be quiet, George. You'll put Madame Arcati off.
Oh, no, darling. I'm certainly used to skeptics. Now then. Would you sit around the table, please, with your hands downwards on it?
What about the lights?
All in good time. Sit down, will you, please? She's my lady love. She is my one and my tittle dove. Oh, our fingers touching, that's right. I presume this is the grand promise, can't I?
Oh, yeah, would you like me to start?
No, stay where you are. I can manage. Round. Oh, dear me, now. And now, whatever. Wrap man and off. Too florid. Where is the dance music?
They're the loose ones on the left.
Oh, I see.
I've heard that none of them very new.
Well, Daphne's really more attached to Irving Berlin than anybody else. She likes the tune she can hum, you know. Well, here's one. Always.
Always?
What's the matter?
Nothing.
Presently, when the music begins, I am going to switch off this light. I may then either move about the room for a bit or lie down flat on the floor. Now, in due course, I shall draw up this dear little stool and join you at the table. I'm going to place myself between you and your wife, Miss Conline, and rest my hands lightly on yours. Now, I must ask you not to address me, or to move, or do anything in the least distracting. Is that quite clear?
Perfect.
Yeah. Now, of course, I can't guarantee that anything will happen at all. See, Daphne might be unavailable. She had a very bad head cold recently. Rather under the weather, poor child. On the other hand, great many things might happen. One of you might have an emanation, for instance. Or we might contact a poltergeist, which would be extremely noisy and destructive.
In what way destructive?
They throw things, you know.
No, I didn't know.
Now then, are you all ready to empty your mind?
I'll do my damnedest.
Well, good work. Now the music, huh? Is there anyone there? One rap for yes, two raps for no. Now then, is there anyone there?
Oh!
Quietly. Is that you, Daphne? Is it cold, better, dear? Yeah, perhaps rather pretzel. Is there anyone there? Wish to speak to anyone here?
Is it Doc Bradman? Is it Mrs. Bradman? Is it Mrs. Condamine? Oh, stop it. Now, you behave yourself. Is it Miss Condamine? Somebody wishes to speak to Miss Condamine.
Oh, tell him to leave a message.
Oh, no, I must ask you. Not to be so flippant.
I'm sorry. I just slipped out.
Well, do you know anyone who's passed over recently?
Recently? My cousin in the civil service. But we haven't spoken to each other for years.
Are you Miss Condamine's cousin in the civil service? No, see, we've drawn a blank. Now, couldn't you think of somebody else? Just rack your brain.
It might be old Mrs. Plummett, you know. She died on Whit Monday.
I can't think what Mrs. Plummett want to talk to me about. We've really got nothing in common at all.
Well, I mean, it's worth trying anyway.
Yeah. Well, are you old Miss Plummett?
She was very deaf. Perhaps you better shout.
Are you old Mrs. Plummett? Oh, I see. No, there's nobody there at all. Well, there's nothing for it. I shall have to go into a trance. I'd hope to avoid it. So exhausting, but what must be, must be. Now, excuse me a minute. I will start the music.
Not always. Don't play always.
Sit down, Charles. Don't be absurd.
Yes. Well, I'm afraid I must, you know, be very unwise to change horses midstream, if you know what I mean.
That would be Daphne. She ought to have her adenoids out.
George, please.
Oh, Lord.
Keep still, Charles.
Oh, trying to get away. I can't hold it.
Press down hard. There now. Leave it where it is.
Who said that?
Who said what?
Well, somebody said, leave it where it is.
Nonsense, dear.
Heard it quite distinctly.
Well, nobody else did they?
Not I.
I never heard a sound.
Good evening, Charles.
Oh, it's ventriloquism. That's what it is, ventriloquism.
What is the matter with you?
Well, you must have heard that. One of you must have heard that.
Heard what?
You sit there solemnly and say that none of you heard anything at all.
I certainly didn't.
Neither did I.
Charles,
you're acting to try to frighten us.
No, I'm not. I swear I'm not.
Difficult to think of what to say after 7 years, but I suppose good evening is as good as anything else.
Who are you?
Elvira, of course. Don't be so silly.
I can't bear another moment of this. Get up, everybody. The entertainment's over.
Charles, what on earth is the matter with
you? Nothing's the matter. I'm just sick of the whole thing.
Dear, look at Madame Arcati.
Oh. What are we to do with her?
Bring her round, and as quickly as possible.
I think you'd better leave her alone.
No, bring her round. It's very dangerous to leave them like that.
It's out, all right.
Charles, you are behaving most peculiarly.
Madame Arcati, wake up. It's time to go home.
Yeah, go easy, old man.
Get her some brandy. Get some brandy.
Right.
Get the handler into a chair.
Yes, yes.
Madame Arcati, little Tommy Tucker. Wake up, Madame Arcati.
Get
wake up.
Get the brandy.
Now, wake up.
Gently.
Look,
she's coming round. Yes.
Be careful, Charles.
You'll
spill it down
her dress.
Oh, well, that's that. Are you all right? Certainly, my dear, I never felt better in my life. What happened? Was it satisfactory?
Nothing much happened, Madame Arcati, after you went off.
Oh, something happened, all right. I can feel it. No poltergeist, at any rate. That's a good thing. No apparitions.
Not a thing?
No ectoplasm?
I don't quite know what it is, but I don't think so.
Well, that's very curious. I feel as though something tremendous has taken place.
Charles pretended to hear a voice in order to frighten us.
Oh, it's just a joke.
A very poor one, if I may say so. Nevertheless, I am prepared to swear there was someone else psychic in this room apart from myself.
I don't see how that could be really, Madame Arcati.
Well, I do hope I didn't go and release something. However, we're bound to find out in a day or two. Now, if any manifestation should occur, or you hear any strange noises, you might let me know at once.
Well, of course we will. We'll telephone immediately.
Yes, I think I'd better be on the way now.
Wouldn't you like to leave your bicycle here and let us drive you?
I honestly do think you should, Madame Arcati.
Oh, nonsense, my dear. No, I am absolutely fit as a fiddle. I always feel capital after a seance. It rejuvenates me. Well, good night, Miss Condamine. We'll try again some other evening.
That would be lovely.
Yes. Oh, good night, Mrs.
It was
thrilling. It really was.
Yeah. And good night, Dr. Pradman.
Congratulations, Madam Arkwright.
Oh, I'm fully aware of that note of irony in your voice. As a matter of fact, you'd be an excellent subject for telepathic hypnosis. Great chum of mine's an expert in the field. Should like it to look you over sometime.
I'm sure I should be charmed.
Well, good night, everybody. Next time it was really put up.
Good night.
Good night. Oh, careful, Mrs. Constantine. She might hear you.
Oh, hello. I really can't. I've been holding this back for ages.
Oh, she said me for junior. And served you right.
Well, she's raving mad. Of course, mad as a hatter.
I must say, though, she shoots a more original line than they generally do.
I do hope, Mr. Constantine got to all the atmosphere he wanted.
He'd have got a great deal more if he hadn't spoiled everything by showing off. I'm really very cross with him. I suddenly felt a draft. Must be a window open.
No, they're shut.
Oh, she's gone peddling off down the drive.
Poor old thing.
Sure. I've got a theory about her. I believe she's absolutely sincere.
Charles, how could she be?
Well, it is possible, Doctor, isn't it? Some sort of form of self-hypnotism.
But it might be. Now, there are certain types of hysterical subjects who are very prone toward suggestion.
We really ought to be going.
Oh, do stay and have a drink before you go.
No, thank you. I'm afraid I've got to get up abominably early tomorrow.
It was a thrilling evening. It was sweet of you to include us.
Good night, Mrs. Condamine. Thank you so much.
We'll let you know if you find any poltergeists swirling about.
I should never forgive you if you didn't.
Come along, John.
Yes,
dear. Good night,
Joseph.
Night, Mrs. Brandon. When the things you planned need a helping hand. Well, darling?
Well?
Would you say the evening had been profitable?
Oh, yes, certainly.
What's the matter?
The matter?
Mm. Seem odd somehow. Do you feel quite well?
Oh, yes, perfectly. I was just going to have another drink. Would you like one?
No, thank you, dear.
A bit chilly in this room.
Well, come over by the fire.
I don't think I'll bother taking any notes tonight. Start fresh in the morning.
Oh. Charles!
That was very clumsy, Charles, dear.
Then it was true. It was you.
Of course it was.
Charles? Darling Charles, what are you talking about?
Are you a ghost?
No, I suppose I must be. It's all very confusing.
Charles? What do you keep looking over there for?
Well, don't you see?
See what?
It's Elvira.
Elvira?
Oh, yeah, oh, I'm sorry. Elvira, dear, this is Ruth. Ruth, this is Elvira.
Come and sit down, darling.
Oh, darling, listen. You don't say you can't see her. She's standing there in front of you. Look.
If this is a joke, dear. It's gone quite far enough. Now sit down and don't be idiotic.
What am I to do? What am I to do?
Well, I think you might at least be a little more pleased to see me. After all, you conjured me out.
I did no such thing.
Nonsense, of course you did. That awful child with the cold came and told me he wanted to see me urgently.
Oh, it was a mistake. A horrible mistake.
Stop talking like that, Charles. As I told you before, the joke's gone far enough.
I've gone mad. That's what it is. I've gone stark raving mad.
Here, let me get you a drink.
Oh, this is appalling.
Oh, darling, relax.
How can I relax? I shall probably never be able to relax again as long as I live.
Drink some brandy.
There, now are you satisfied?
Now sit down.
You're so anxious for me to sit down. What good is that going to do?
I want you to relax. You can't relax standing up.
African natives can. They can stand on one leg for hours.
I don't happen to be an African native.
You don't happen to be a what?
An African native.
What's that got to do with it?
Ruth, forget all about it. Just don't worry about it. Don't bother. Ah, shut.
Would you like some more brandy?
Yes, please.
Very unwise. You always had a weak head.
I could drink you under the table.
There's no need to be aggressive, Charles.
I'm doing my best to help you.
I'm sorry.
Drink this, then we'll go to bed.
Get rid of her, Charles, then we can talk in peace.
It's a thoroughly immoral suggestion. You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
What is there immoral in that?
I wasn't talking to you.
Who were you talking to, then?
To Elvira.
Well, to hell with Elvira.
There now, she's getting cross.
And I don't blame her.
Now, look here, Charles. I gather you've got some sort of a plan behind all this. I suspected you when we were doing that idiotic sale.
Don't be ridiculous. What kind of plan could I possibly have?
I don't know. It's something to do with some of the characters in your book, how they would react to a certain situation. Well, I refuse to be used as a guinea pig unless I'm warned beforehand what it's all about.
Listen, Ruth. Ruth, listen. Elvira is here. She's sitting just a few yards away from you.
Yes, dear. I can see her distinctly. Under the table with a horse.
Oh, Ruth.
I'm not going to stay here arguing with you a moment longer.
Hooray.
Don't shut up!
How dare you speak to me like that?
Oh, Ruth, please, listen to me.
I'm now going upstairs.
Listen to me.
I believe you turn out the lights. I shan't be asleep because I'm far too upset. You can come in and say goodnight to me if you feel like it.
Oh, that's big of her, I must say.
Don't be quiet. You're behaving like a gutter snipe.
That is all I have to say. Good night, Charles.
Ruth!
One of the most enjoyable half hours I've ever spent.
Elvira, how could you?
Oh, poor Ruth.
This is obviously some sort of hallucination, isn't it?
Well, I'm afraid I don't know the technical term for it.
What am I to do?
What Ruth suggested will that.
Where have you come from?
Well, do you know, it's very peculiar. You've sort of forgotten.
Are you going to stay indefinitely?
Don't know that either. Would you hate it so much if I did?
Well, you must admit it would be embarrassing.
Oh, I don't see why, really. It's all a question of adjusting yourself. Anyhow, I think it's horrid of you to be so disagreeable and unwelcome.
Now, look here, Elvira.
No, I do, really. I think you're mean.
Well, Elvira, you must see my point, dear. Ruth and I have been married for 5 years, and you've been dead for 7.
Oh, not dead, Charles. Passed over. It's considered vulgar to say dead where I come from.
Well, I've been passed over.
I don't believe you love me anymore.
Well, I shall always love the memory of you.
No, I really am a little hurt. You called me back, and a great inconvenience I came. And you've been thoroughly churlish ever since I arrived.
Elvira, believe me, I emphatically did not call you back.
Well, somebody did.
Well, it wasn't me.
Oh, Charles.
What's the matter?
I want to cry, but I don't think I'm able to.
What do you want to cry for?
It's seeing you again and you being so irascible, like you always used to be.
I don't mean to be irascible.
Oh, darling, I don't mind really. I never did.
Is it cold? Being a ghost?
No, I don't think so.
What happens if I touch you?
Well, I doubt if you can. Do you want to?
Oh, Elvira.
What is it, darling?
It's very strange seeing you again.
Oh, that's better.
What's better?
Your voice was kinder.
But was I ever unkind to you when you were alive?
Often.
Oh, I love you very much.
And I love you, Elvira. You see? I can't touch you. Isn't it awful?
Maybe it's just as well if I'm going to stay for any length of time.
I'm beginning to feel rather peaceful. I suppose I shall come to eventually.
Put your head back.
What do you mean, like this?
Mm. Can you feel anything?
Hmm?
Did you feel anything?
Oh, no, just a very little breeze through my hair.
Oh, well, that's better than nothing.
I suppose if I'd gone out of my mind, they'd put me in the asylum.
Oh, don't worry about that. Just relax.
Poor Ruth.
To hell, my Ruth.
After station identification, we'll return for the second act of Blithe Spirit, brought to you with the compliments of the fine stores that feature Hallmark cards. ¶¶
certain is.
What certain is what?
A good morning, a tremendously good morning. There isn't a cloud in the sky and everything looks newly washed. Anything interesting at the Times?
Don't be silly, Charles.
Isn't it extraordinary about daylight?
How do you mean?
Well, how it reduces everything to normal.
Does it?
Yes. Yes, it does.
I'm sure I'm very glad to hear it.
You're very glacial this morning, dear.
Are you surprised?
Yes, I am really. I've always looked upon you as a woman of great perception and understanding.
Perhaps this is one of my off days. Why don't you eat your breakfast while it's hot?
It isn't.
Now look here, Charles. In your younger days, this display of roguish flippancy might have been alluring. In a middle-aged novelist, it's nauseating.
I honestly don't see what I've done that's so awful.
You behaved abominably last night. You wounded me and insulted me.
I was the victim of an aberration.
Nonsense, you were drunk.
You just... drunk?
You had four strong dry martinis before dinner. A great deal too much burgundy at dinner. Heaven knows how much port with Dr. Bradman. And two double brandies later. I gave them to you myself. Of course, you were drunk.
That's your story.
You refused to come to bed. And when finally I came down at 3 in the morning to see what had happened to you, I found you in an alcoholic coma on the sofa with a fire out and your hair all over your face.
Ruth, I was not in the least drunk. Something very peculiar happened to me last night.
Nonsense.
It is not nonsense. I honestly had an hallucination. I was convinced that Elvira was here. I saw her, quite distinctly. I talked to her. After you got up to bed, we had really quite a cosy little chat.
You seriously expect me to believe that you weren't drunk?
Now, if I'd been drunk, I should have the most awful hangover today.
I'm not at all sure that you haven't.
I haven't the least trace of a headache. My tongue isn't coated. Look.
I have not the least desire to look at your tongue. Kindly put it in again.
I know what it is, of course. You're frightened.
Frightened? Rubbish. What's there to be frightened of?
Elvira, you tried to make me say that she was physically more attractive than you so that you could hold it over me.
I did not. I don't give a hoot how physically attractive she was.
Oh, yes, you do. Your whole being is devoured with jealousy.
This is too much. Just because you've always been dominated by women, it doesn't necessarily follow that you know anything about them.
I have never been dominated by anyone.
You were hag-ridden by your mother till you were 23. Then you got into the clutches of that dreadful Mrs. whatever her name
Winthrop
was.
Winthrop threw in.
Then it was Elvira. She ruled you with a rod of iron.
Elvira never ruled anyone. She was far too elusive for that. That was one of her greatest charms.
It was Lord Charles.
Look, dear, if you're about to make an inventory of my sex life, I think it's only fair to point out to you that you've missed out on a few episodes. I shall consult my diary at luncheon and give you a complete list.
No use trying to impress me with your routine amorous exploits.
The only woman who's ever attempted to dominate me is you. You've been at it for years.
That is completely untrue.
Oh, no, it's not. You boss me, you bully me, you order me about.
I consider that I'm remarkably patient. You seem to forget that you called me a guttersnipe. You told me to shut up. And when I quietly suggested that we should go upstairs to bed, you said with the most disgusting leer that it was an immoral suggestion.
I was talking to Elvira.
If you were, I can only say that it conjures up a fragrant picture of your first marriage.
Can I clear, please, Mum?
Yes, Edith.
A cook wants to know about lunch, Mum.
Oh, will you be in to lunch, Charles?
Don't bother about me. I shall be perfectly all right in my bedroom with a bottle of gin.
Don't be silly, dear. Tell cook we'll both be in.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm going into Hyde's this morning. Is there anything you want?
A great deal, but I doubt if you get it in Hyde.
Sure you can manage, all right, Edith?
Yes, sir.
Ruth. Ruth, please be reasonable.
I'm perfectly reasonable.
Look, I wasn't pretending. I really thought I saw Elvira.
Nonsense. You couldn't have seen
her. I know I couldn't have done, but I did.
I'm willing to concede, then, that you imagined that you did.
That is all that I am trying to explain to you.
Well, then there's something obviously the matter with you. I mean, did you feel quite well yesterday, during the day, I mean?
Yes, of course.
What did you have for lunch?
Well, you ought to know you have the same as me.
Let me see, there was lemon sole and that cheese thing.
Well, why should the cheese thing at lunch make me see my deceased wife after dinner?
Well, you never know. It was rather rich.
Well, why didn't you see your dead husband? You had as much of it as I did.
Oh, this isn't getting us anywhere at all. I think I'd better ring up Dr. Bradman.
You've absolutely ruined this conservatory. It looks like a mixed star.
salad.
Ruth!
Ruth! What's the matter now?
She's here again.
Who's here again?
Elvira.
It's all those nasturtiums. They're so vulgar.
I happen to like nasturtiums.
You happen to like what? Oh, well, they're all right in moderation. But in a mass like that, they look beastly.
Ruth. Ruth, please, you must help me. Please help me.
What did you mean about nasturtiums?
I'll explain to you all about that later. She's here again, I tell you.
You're trying to upset me, no. Charles. For some obscure reason, you're trying to goad me into doing something that I might regret.
No.
Well, I'm not going to put up with it anymore because you're making me utterly miserable.
Ruth, please,
no,
please.
Don't come near me.
Let her have a nice cry. It'll do her good.
No, you're being utterly heartless.
Heartless?
I was talking to Elvira.
Oh, go on, talking to Elvira. Then talk to her till you're blue in the face, but don't talk to me.
Elvira, you must help me.
How?
To make her see you or something.
Oh, Elvira couldn't do that. It's technically the most difficult business. It's years of study.
Look, you are really here, aren't you? You're not just an illusion.
I may be an illusion, but I am most definitely here. Charles.
Yes, dear?
I'm awfully sorry I was cross.
Dear,
I understand everything now. I do, really.
You do?
Of course I do. Oh, look out. She's up to something.
Will you please be quiet?
Of course, dear. We'll all be quiet, won't we? We'll be as quiet as little mice.
Yes, now listen, Ruth.
Charles, I want you to come upstairs with me and go to bed.
But, my dear, I would much rather not go to bed in the middle of the morning.
How you've changed, darling.
Don't be disgusting.
I'm sorry, dear. I didn't mean to be.
You must help me. You've got to help me.
But my dear, I would with pleasure, but I can't think how.
I can. Now, Ruth.
Yes, dear.
Ruth, will you bear with me just for a few moments longer? However mad it may seem, will you bear with me?
Very well. What is it?
Well, sit down.
All right. There.
Now, Ruth, do you see that little bowl of flowers on the table?
Yes, dear, I did it myself this morning.
Very untidily, if I may say so.
You may not.
Very well, dear, I never will again, I promise.
Ruth, now, Elvira will carry that bowl of flowers across the room. You will, Elvira, won't you, please? Just to please me.
I don't really see why I should. You've been quite insufferable ever since I materialized.
Please.
Oh, all right.
Now, Ruth.
Yes, dear.
You watch carefully. All right, Elvira, off you go.
How dare you, Charles? You ought to be ashamed of yourself.
What on earth are you talking about?
It's a trick. I know perfectly well it's a trick. You've been working up to this. It's part of some horrible plan.
No, Vera, do something else.
Oh, certainly anything to oblige. Oh.
You want to get rid of me? You're trying to drive me out of my mind.
I'm not going to put up with this a moment longer.
Ruth, you've got to believe.
Let
you must
me
believe.
Go immediately.
But that was Elvira.
Let me go.
Ruth.
Charles, this is some sort of auto-suggestion, isn't it? Some form of hypnotism? Swear to me it's only that.
Hypnotism, my foot.
Profoundly disturbed, Madame Arcati. And I want your help.
Take the plunge, Miss Carnamine. Out with it.
Well, it's most awfully difficult to explain.
Facts first, explanations afterwards.
It's the facts that are difficult to explain. They're so fantastic.
Well, facts very often are... take creative talent, for instance. How are you going to account for that? Look at Shakespeare, Michelangelo. Try to explain Mozart. Snatching sounds out of the air, setting them down on paper when he was practically a baby. Facts, plain facts. I know it's the fashion nowadays to ascribe it all to glands. My reply to that is fiddle-dee-dee.
Yes, I'm sure you're quite right.
Oh, yes. There are more things in heaven and earth than are dreamed of in your philosophy, Miss Condamine. Have one of those cucumber sandwiches. They're just delicious.
No, thank you. Madame Arcati, I know it sounds idiotic, but... the other evening during the seance, something happened.
I knew it. Probably a poltergeist.
They're enormously cunning. They sometimes lie doggo for days.
You know my husband was married before.
Oh, I have heard it mentioned.
Well, his first wife, Elvira, died comparatively young.
Where?
In the same house we have now.
She materialized the other evening after I'd gone.
Not to me, but to my husband.
Oh, this capitalism is splendid.
From your own professional point of view, I can see that it might be considered a major achievement.
Triumph, my dear. Nothing more nor less than a triumph.
But from my own personal standpoint, it is, to say the least of it, embarrassing.
At last, a genuine materialization.
I would like to point out that it has made my position untenable and that I hold you entirely responsible.
Oh, forgive me, Miss Condamine, I'm being abominably selfish. How can I help you?
How? By sending her back immediately to where she came from, of course.
Well, I'm afraid that's easier said than done. Forgive this formality. I must make a report to the psychical research people. Now, visible only to husband. Audible too, I presume?
Extremely audible.
Extremely audible. Husband devoted to her?
I believe so.
Husband devoted.
It was apparently a reasonably happy marriage.
Would you say that she was a woman of strong character?
I really don't know, Madame Arcati. I never met her. Nor am I particularly interested in how and why she got here. I am solely concerned with the question of how to get her away again, as soon as possible.
Well, I'm afraid the time has come for me to admit to you frankly, Miss Condamine, haven't the faintest idea how to set about it.
This is outrageous. I ought to hand you over to the police.
Oh, I was in a trance. You know, anything might happen in a trance.
All I can suggest is that you go into another one immediately and get that woman out of my house.
But I just can't go into a trance at a moment's notice. These things take hours of preparation, in addition to which I have to be extremely careful in my diet. Those cucumber sandwiches make a trance out of question.
You have to do something.
I will. Make a report to the Psychical Research Society at the earliest possible moment.
Will they be able to do anything?
I doubt it.
Madame Arcati, you are entirely to blame for the whole horrible situation.
Oh, well, I resent your tone, Miss Condamine. I really do.
You most decidedly have no right to.
I did what I was requested to do, which was to give a science and to make contact with the other side. Now, I had no idea there were any ulterior motives mixed up with it at all.
Ulterior motives?
Yes. Oh, yes, your husband was obviously eager to get in touch with his former wife. Now, if I had known this, I should have naturally consulted you beforehand. After all, noblesse oblige.
He had no intention of trying to get into touch with anyone. The whole thing was planned in order for him to get material for a mystery story he's writing about a homicidal medium.
Why, am I to understand? I was invited only in a spirit of mockery.
Not at all. He merely wanted to make some notes of some of the tricks of the trade.
Tricks of the trade? Oh, this is really insufferable. I've never been so insulted in my life. Miss Condamine, I should like to say, without umbrage, if you and your husband were foolish enough to tamper with the unseen for paltry motives and in a spirit of ribaldry, whatever's happened to you is your own fault. And to coin a phrase, as far as I'm concerned, you can stew in your own juice.
You have no right to go to Madame Arcati without consulting me first.
I have every right. The situation is absolutely impossible, and you know it.
Why her?
To get me exercised, of course.
Is that true?
Is what true?
What Elvira said.
You know perfectly well that I can't hear what Elvira said.
Elvira said that you went to Madame Arcati in order to get her exorcised. Is that true?
We discussed the possibility. There's a snake in the grass for you.
She's naturally a little upset. We must make allowances.
Where is Elvira at the moment?
Sitting on the stairs.
Now look here, Elvira. I shall have to call you Elvira, shan't I? I can't very well go on saying Mrs. Condamine all the time. It would sound too silly.
I don't see why.
Did she say anything?
She said she'd like nothing better.
Oh, you really are sweet, Charles, darling. I worship you. I wish to be perfectly honest with you, Elvira.
Oh, hold on to your hats, boys.
Oh. I admit that I did go to Madame Arcati with a view to getting you exercised, and I think that if you were in my position, you'd done exactly the same thing, wouldn't you?
Only I shouldn't have done it so obviously.
What did she say?
She just smiled and nodded.
Oh. Thank you very much, Elvira. Very generous of you. Now, before I go any further, I'd like to ask you a frank question. Why did you really come here? I can't see that you could have hoped to have achieved anything by it beyond the immediate joke of making Charles into a sort of astral bigamist.
I came because the power of Charles's love tugged and tugged and tugged at me. Didn't it, my sweet?
What did she say?
She said that she came back because she wanted to see me again.
Well, she's done that now, isn't she?
Ruth, we can't be inhospitable.
I have no wish to be inhospitable. I should just like to have an idea of how long you intend to stay, Elvira.
I don't know. I really don't know. Isn't it awful?
She said she doesn't know.
Surely that's a little inconsiderate.
Oh, no, Ruth, listen. I'm sure we shall adjust ourselves, you know. And it is a very unique experience. I see no valid reason why we shouldn't all get a great deal of fun out of it.
Fun? Oh, Charles, how can you?
She's off again.
Oh, Elvira, you must stop being so callous. Do try and see her point a little.
I suppose she said something insulting.
No, 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 my dear. She said nothing of the sort.
Now, look here, Elvira.
Ruth.
Yes?
She's in the other room now.
Oh, why the hell can't she stay in the same place?
Temper again. Oh, my poor Charles, what a terrible life you must lead.
No, do shut up, darling. You'll spoil everything.
So who was that darling addressed to, her or me?
Both of you.
This is intolerable.
Oh, Ruth, don't get into another mistake.
I have been doing my level best to control myself, but she has the advantage of being able to say whatever she pleases without me being able to hear her. But she can hear me all right, can't she, without any modified interpreting?
Modified interpreting? I don't know what you mean.
Oh, yes. You haven't told me once what she really said. You wouldn't dare. Well, I don't like Elvira any more than she likes me. And what's more, I'm certain that I never could have, dead or alive. I'm now going to my room. I shall have my dinner on a tray. You and she can joke and gossip to your heart's content. Because first thing in the morning, I'm going up to London to interview the Psychical Research Society. And if they fail me, I shall go straight to the Archbishop of Canterbury.
Ruth.
If you love her...
Of course I do.
As much as you love me.
Don't be so silly. I'm all entirely different.
Oh, I'm so glad. Nothing could ever have been quite the same.
You've always behaved very badly.
Oh, sir.
It grieves me to see that your sojourn in the other world has done so little to improve you.
Oh, go on, darling. I love it when you pretend to be cross with me.
What do you want, Elvira?
Want? I don't know what you mean.
Well, I seem to remember that when you were overpoweringly demure, it usually meant that you wanted something.
Oh, I think it's horrid of you to be suspicious. All I want is to be with you.
This is absolutely essential.
It's a wise precaution. It will prevent you using your left hand except when it's really necessary.
I had hoped to drive into Folkestone this evening.
It would be much better if you didn't.
Oh, Charles, I can't stand another of those dreary evenings at home. It'll drive me dotty.
You can easily wait and go tomorrow, Charles.
I haven't seen a movie in 7 years.
Allow me to be the first to congratulate you.
What's that, old man?
Charles, dear. Try to be sensible. I implore you.
I'm sorry, I forgot. Couldn't you drive him in?
I'm afraid not. I have lots to do in the house, and there's Edith to be attended to.
Well, I'll leave you to fight it out among yourselves. But remember, if you do insist on going, carefully does it. The roads are very slippery. Goodbye, Charles.
Thanks. Goodbye.
I'll see you out, Dr. Brown.
Thank you. Don't worry about your husband's arm, Mrs. Condamine. I'm sure it's only a sprain.
It's not his arm I'm worried about.
I want to talk to you about Charles. I'm afraid he's been overworking lately.
Overworking?
He's in rather a nervous condition. But it's nothing serious, you understand. But there's a certain air of strain, an inability to focus his eyes on the person he's talking to. A few marked irrelevances in his conversation.
He often carries on like that when he's immersed in writing a book. How is poor Edith?
Oh, it's a nasty concussion. But she'll be all right in a few days. Funny, isn't it, that your housemaid and your husband should fall down on the same day?
Yes. if that sort of thing amuses you.
Now, I'll pop in and have a look at both patients sometime tomorrow morning. Goodbye, Mrs.
Thank Dunaway. You, Doctor, very much. Goodbye. Oh, on both sides.
Well, why does she want to kill me? I can understand her wanting to kill you, but why me?
Because if you were dead, it would be her final triumph over me. She'd have you with her forever on a bloody astral plane, and I'd be left high and dry.
Rude.
You see now.
Oh, but she couldn't. Oh, she couldn't be so wicked, so sly. Oh, she couldn't.
Couldn't she just?
Well, I grant you that as a character, she's always been rather light and frivolous, but I honestly don't believe she could stoop to low cunning.
Perhaps the spirit world deteriorated her.
Rude.
Stop looking like a wounded spaniel and concentrate.
What are we to do?
You're not to let her know that we suspect a thing. Behave perfectly ordinarily as though nothing had happened. I'm going immediately to Madame Arcati. I don't care how cross she is. She's got to help us. Even if she can't get rid of Elvira, she must know some technical method of rendering her harmless. If a trance is necessary, she shall go into a trance. If I've got to beat her into one, I'll be back in half an hour. Tell Elvira I've gone to see the vicar.
This is appalling.
Remember now, don't give yourself away by so much as a flick of an eyelid.
Oh.
Are you ready, Charles?
What for?
Well, to take me to the movies, of course.
I think I'd like a glass of sherry before I go.
I don't believe you want to take me at all.
Of course I want to take you. I just think it's wiser to put it off till tomorrow. It's a filthy night.
Oh, how familiar this is.
Familiar in what way?
Oh, all through our married life, I had only to suggest something for you to immediately start hedging me off.
I'm not hedging you off. I merely simply be better.
All right. We'll spend another cozy, intimate evening at home. The dear Ruth sawing away at that hideous table center and snapping at us like a terrier.
Ruth is perfectly well aware that the table center is hideous. It happens to be a birthday present for her mother.
There's no use defending Ruth's taste to me. It's thoroughly artsy craftsy, and you know it.
If you don't behave yourself, I shan't take you to Folkestone ever.
Please, Charles. Oh, don't be elderly and grand with me. Please, let's go now.
I haven't finished my sherry. Oh. And the car won't be back for half an hour at least.
What do you mean?
Well, Ruth's taken it. She had to go and see the vicar.
What?
Well, what's the matter?
Is it Ruth taken the car?
I'm sure she won't be long.
Oh! You must stop her at once.
Oh, what for?
Oh, stop her. Stop it immediately.
Well, it's too late now.
Oh!
What are you going like that for? What have you done?
I haven't done anything.
Elvira, you're lying.
No, I'm not lying. What is there to lie about?
Well, why are you in such a state?
I'm not in a state.
You've done something dreadful.
Oh, Charles, don't look at me like that. I haven't.
The car!
No, Charles, no!
Ruth was right. You did want to kill me. You've done something to the car!
No.
What have you done? Answer me! Hello? Yes, he's speaking. I see. The bridge at the bottom of the hill. No, I'll come over right away. Thank you very much.
Of all the low down filthy tricks.
Speaking.
Madame Arcati here. I have to speak with you. I reproach myself bitterly, you know. I allowed myself to get into a huff the other day with your late wife. I have regretted it ever since.
You were perfectly honest.
Over and above the original unfortunate mistake, I don't think you've got anything at all to reproach yourself for.
But I threw up the sponge. In a moment of crisis, I threw up the sponge instead of throwing down the gauntlet.
Well, whatever you threw, Madame Arcati, I very much doubt if anything could have been done.
Oh, no, I can't bring myself to admit defeat so easily. Are you still anxious to dematerialize your first wife?
Yes, of course, but I
gather you're alone. You can talk.
Yes, yes. My first wife is lying down upstairs. The funeral exhausted her. I imagine my second wife is with her. She hasn't left her side for a moment. Of course, I've no way of being certain.
It came to me last night, Miss Carnamine. It came to me in a blinding flash. Just finished me Ovaltine, turned out the light. All of a sudden, I started up in bed with a loud cry. Great Scott, I said, I got it.
Well, what are you talking about, Madame?
Well, I found the formula.
Oh.
It's in Edmondson's Witchcraft and its Byways. Now, it's absolutely simple. All it requires is complete concentration from you and a minor trance from me.
I'd really rather not, Madame. I don't want to go through the whole thing again. Please.
Who were you talking to, darling?
Madame Arcati. She called to offer her condolences.
Well, there should have been congratulations.
Please don't say things like that, Elvira.
How good is she, really?
I don't know.
Do you think she really could get me back again?
Faintest idea. We shall know very soon. She's coming over here now to do or attempt exactly that.
Oh, Charles. The whole thing's been the most miserable, dreary failure. And what high hopes I started out with.
You can't expect very much sympathy from me, my dear. I know that your highest hope was to murder me.
Don't put it like that. It sounds beastly.
Well, it is beastly. It's about the beastliest idea I've ever heard.
There was a time when you would have welcomed the chance of being with me forever and ever.
Your behavior shocked me immeasurably, Elvira. I had no idea that you could be so unscrupulous.
Oh, Charles.
Oh, stop crying. You brought it all on yourself, you know.
Oh, that's right. Rub it in. Anyhow, it was only because I loved you. The silliest thing I ever did in my whole life was to love you. You were always unworthy of me.
That remark comes perilously near impertinence, Elvira.
I sat there on the other side, just longing for you day after day. I did, really. That's why I put myself down for a return visit and had to fill in all those forms and wait about in drafty passages for hours. Oh, if only you died before you met Ruth, everything might have been all right. She's absolutely ruined you. I hadn't been in the house a day before I realized that. And your books aren't a quarter as good as they used to be, either.
That's entirely untrue. Ruth helped me and encouraged me in my work, which is much more than you ever did.
That's probably what's wrong with it.
All you ever thought about was going to parties and enjoying yourself.
Oh, why shouldn't I have had fun and died young, didn't I?
You needn't have died at all if you'd been so idiotic. You've gone out on the river with Guy Henderson. Got soaked to the skin.
So we're back to Guy Henderson, are we?
You behaved abominably with Guy Henderson. His name was pretending that you didn't.
Guy adored me. And anyhow, he was very attractive.
You told me distinctly that he didn't attract you in the least.
Well, you'd have gone through the roof if I told you that he did.
Did you have an affair with Guy Henderson?
I'd rather not discuss it.
No, answer me. Did you or didn't you?
Of course I didn't.
But you let him kiss you, didn't you?
Well, how could I stop him? He was bigger than I was.
And you swore to me.
Oh, well, of course I did, because you were always making scenes about nothing at all.
Nothing at all?
Oh, you never loved me a bit, really. It was all your beastly vanity.
Vanity? Do you seriously think it was only vanity which upset me when you went in the punt with Guy Henderson?
It was not a punt. It was a little launch.
I don't care if it was a three-masted schooner. You'd no right to go.
You seem to forget why I went. You seem to forget that you'd spent the entire evening making sheep's eyes of that overblown Harridan with the false pearls.
A woman in Cynthia Cheviot's position would hardly wear false pearls.
They were practically all she was wearing.
There is nothing to be gained by continuing this discussion.
You always used to say that when you were thoroughly worsted.
Looking back over our married years, Elvira, I can see with horrid clarity that they were nothing but a mockery.
You invite mockery, Charles. It has something to do with your personality, I think. A certain seedy grandeur.
Now, look, you're once for all.
You never suspected it, but I laughed at you steadily from the altar to the grave. All your ridiculous, petty jealousies and your fussings and
you were heckless and irresponsible and morally unstable. I realized that long before we left Budley Salterton.
Nobody but a monumental bore would have thought of having a honeymoon at Budley Salterton.
And what is the matter with Budley Salterton?
I was an eager young bride, Charles. I wanted music and glamour and romance. All I got was potted palms, 7 hours a day on a damp golf course, and a three-piece orchestra playing Merry England.
Well, except that you didn't tell me at the time.
I did, but you wouldn't listen. That's why I went out in the moors that day with Captain Bracegirdle. I was desperate.
You swore to me that you'd gone to see your aunt in Exmouth.
It was the moors.
With Captain Bracegirdle.
With Captain Bracegirdle.
I might have known. What a fool I've been. What a blind fool. Did he make love to you?
Of course.
Elfia.
Only very discreetly. He was in the cavalry, you know.
But all I can say is that I'm well rid of you.
Unfortunately, you're not.
I am. You are dead. And Ruth is dead. And I'm leaving this house and going away. And that'll be Madame Arcati now.
Well, set her to work and tell her I want to go home.
And the sooner the better. Ah, Madame Arcati, good evening.
Miss Carnamine, I do hope you won't consider this an intrusion, but I had to come. I feel I've been dreadfully remiss about this whole affair. Not only remiss, but untidy.
Madame Arcati, may I introduce my first wife, Elvira?
Oh, how you do, dear.
Tell her I want to go home as quickly as possible. I'm sick of the whole thing.
Well, it's very interesting, very interesting. I can smell ectoplasm strongly.
What a disgusting thing to say.
Don't shut up, Elvira.
Really? Oh, well, where is she now?
Go on, Elvira. Don't be a spoil sport. Well, give her a bit of encouragement.
If you'll promise to get her to send me back.
All right.
Oh, yes, yes. again. How's that?
This is first rate. This is really first rate. This is absolutely stunning.
Well, I'm very glad that you're pleased, Madame Arcati. Now, Elvira wants to go home immediately.
Home?
Well, wherever she comes from.
Oh, well, you don't think she'd like to stay a day or two longer? I could come over here with her.
No.
Bring my crystal.
I want to go home now.
We have agreed that she shall return as soon as possible. So will you strain every nerve, Madame Arcati? Make every effort. You said something about a formula on the telephone. What was it?
I'm going to do my best, but it may not work. Would you hand me my bag over there? Oh, you little darling, you little darling.
What is the formula?
Well, it's nothing more really than a little verse. It fell out of disuse after the 17th century. Now, you won't be frightened, will you, dear? It's absolutely painless. Where? Oh, yes. Some salt. That's right. And pepper. Yeah, that's it. Just a soup salt. Right there in the middle. Mr. Connor, a few of those snapdragons from that vase. There's a good chap. Shucks, I nearly forgot. One triangle, one half circle, one little dot. Bang.
This is going to be a flop. I can tell you that here and now.
Do shut up.
Well, Merlin does all this sort of thing at parties and bars. It's all stiff with it.
Now then, the gramophone. We better use the same record we used before, I think. Yeah, of course I ought to have some shepherd's wort and a frog or two, but I think I'd manage without it. Oh, if Mr. Ems was at the Psychical Research Society could see this, he'd have a fit. He would, really. Miss Conn, my dear, would you sit down there, place your hands on the table, and don't put your fingers in the pepper. Now, if your wife would be so kind as to lie down on the sofa.
Go and lie down.
This is a waste of time.
Anything is worth trying.
I'm eager for it to succeed as you are. Don't make any mistake about that.
Well, just concentrate. Think of nothing.
Yes, that's right. Now, hands at the side, legs extended. Steady breathing. One, two, one, two, one, two. Is she comfortable?
Are you comfortable?
No.
She's comfortable.
Ghostly spectre, ghoul or fiend, nevermore be thou convened. Shepherd's wort or holy rite, banish thee into the night.
What a disagreeable little verse.
Light.
shut.
Just be quiet. Is anyone there? Is there anyone there? One rap for yes, two raps for no. Now then, is there anyone there? Good stuff. Is that you, Daphne? Oh, I'm sorry to bother you, dear. Mrs. Condamine wants to return. Oh, hang on. Oh, don't let her break away. Oh, yes.
Madam McCarty, are you all right? Are you hurt? Oh, what on earth's going on here?
She's in one of her stupid trances again, and I'm here as much as I ever was.
Madam McCarty, are you all right? Are you hurt?
If I ever do get back, I shall strangle that bloody little Daphne.
What happened?
Nothing, nothing at all.
Oh, yes, it is. Oh, something happened. Is she still here?
Yes, of course she is.
Well, something happened, all right. I could sense it in my trance. I feel it now. It shivered right through me.
Chance. What the hell does this mean?
Ghostly spectre. Earthbound's off. Turf. Twist in my crystal ball. Melt away. Disappear. There. That should have done it. I'll be gone.
No.
Don't be downhearted. We're gonna win through yet.
Well, all I can say is that this is the most frustrating evening I've ever spent.
If that really were all you could say, Ruth, I'm sure it would be a great comfort to us.
You can be as rude as you like, Elvira. I don't mind a bit. In fact, I should be extremely surprised if you were. No.
I do wish you two would stop bickering just for one moment.
Yeah.
Madame Arcardi's doing her best.
Girls getting despondent?
Yes, they are, rather.
Oh, well, Miss Conamine, now, I don't suppose you've got a saw handy or a hatchet. Here,
Maud,
it's
a
pearl.
Curl up, resources, free, disparate. Oh, I think you're. No. Don't you think, Madame Arcardi, perhaps
you've tried enough? Oh, Rome wasn't built in a day.
I know it wasn't.
Oh, cheer up, away with melancholy. Will you be so kind as to hand me those garlands of garlic? Still here? How disappointing. Well, must give up hope. Chin up, never give in. That's my motto.
This schoolgirl phraseology is driving me mad.
For heaven's sake, Charles, don't let us throw any more of that garlic about. It's making me sick.
What do you say we have another seance?
Oh.
Really put a shoulder to the wheel, make it a rouser.
Now, look, Madame McCarty, before you go into another of your trances, I really do think we ought to talk this situation over.
Excellent idea. While we're doing it, I'm going to have another one of these delicious old sandwiches. I am hungry as a hunter. Now then, Miss Condamine, fire ahead.
My wives and I have been talking things over, and they are absolutely convinced that somehow or other I called them back.
Very natural.
And I am equally convinced that I did not, either consciously or subconsciously.
But Miss Conrad, neither of them could have appeared if there hadn't been somebody, a psychic subject in the house, who really wished for them.
Well, it wasn't me.
Well, perhaps it was Dr. Bradman. I never knew he cared.
Great Scott, I believe I've been barking up the wrong tree.
What do you mean?
Well, the Sudbury case. This is the case, of course, I was famous for. It's what you might describe in theatrical parlance as my first smash hit.
What did you do?
Well, I dematerialized old Lady Sudbury after she'd been firmly entrenched in her private chapel over 17 years. Now, let's see. Who was in the house the night of the first seance?
Well, the Bradmans, Ruth, myself, and you.
Yes, for sure. But the Bradmans weren't here last night, were they?
No.
Oh, my Christmas. Darn this thing. This gives me the pip. It's cloudy again. Oh, there's better. It's there again. It's there again. I'm beginning to understand.
I wish I was. What's there again?
A bandage, a white bandage. Hold on to a white bandage.
I haven't got a white bandage.
She's too good, you know. She ought to be in a circus.
Be you a nook or cranny, answer me. Be you in still room or closet, answer me. Be you behind that panel above the stairs, beneath the eaves, waking or sleeping, answer me. That ought to do it, or I'm a Dutchman.
Do what?
Wait, wait. It's near. Very near. Wait, it's near.
Did you ring, sir?
The bandage, the white bandage.
No, Edith.
Well, I'm sorry, sir. I could have sworn I heard the bell or somebody call and I was asleep.
Come here, child.
Oh? It's all right. Go to Madame Octavia.
Yes. Whom do you see in this room, child?
Oh, dear.
Answer, please.
You, madam, the master.
Yeah, anyone else?
Oh, no, madam.
Look again.
I don't understand.
Come on, child, now. Don't beat around the bush. Look again. Where are they now?
In the fireplace.
Oh, she can see them? You mean she can see them?
Not clearly, but enough.
Let me go. I haven't done nothing. I've seen nobody. Let me go back to bed.
Sit down.
It was Madame Marcotte, says.
I haven't done nothing wrong.
No, I know you have. Nobody said you have.
Edith, look at me.
Cuckoo. What happens? What's the matter with her? Is she balmy?
Here, Edith. Look. This is my finger, Gypsy. Such a long, long, long finger. Look, now to the right, now to the left. Backward, forward, very quietly. Backward, forward. Tick-tock, tick-tock, tick-tock.
Mouse ran up the clock.
Shh, you will ruin everything. So far, so good. She's off, all right.
Off?
She's a natural, just the same as in the Sudbury case. Oh, it's really the most amusing coincidence. Anyway, would you have your wives stand close together?
Where?
Over there with you.
Yeah, yes. Ruth, Elvira?
I resent being ordered about like this.
I don't like this at all. I feel peculiar.
I'm sorry, I must insist.
You know what you have to do now.
Yes, madam.
It's going to work, whatever it is. Oh, Charles! This is goodbye, Charles.
Tell her to stop for a minute. There's something I want to say before I go.
You should have thought of that before. It's too late now.
Charles,
mean please
listen.
Don't think you're getting rid of us quite so easily, my dear. I saw Captain Bracegirdle again, Charles.
They've gone. They've really gone.
Splendid, hurrah! We pulled it off this time. Quite enough singing for the moment, Edith. Wake up, child.
Clarence, where am I?
Oh, it's all right, Edith. You can go back to bed now.
But I was in bed. How did it get down here?
I rang a bell and you answered it. Didn't I, Madame Arcadia?
Oh, did I drop off? Do you think it's my concussion again?
Off you go, Edith. And thank you. Thank you very much indeed.
Oh, sir, whatever for? Oh, sir!
What on earth did she mean by that?
Oh, what a night. I am ready to drop in my tracks.
I'm most grateful to you, Madame Arcadia. I trust you'll send in your account at the soonest possible moment.
Oh, good heavens, come to mind. I wouldn't dream of such a thing. It was a pleasure. Could I just have one more of those delicious little sandwiches to munch on the way?
Yes, by all means.
Oh, thank you so much. Well, it was fascinating just from the first moment to the last. It was fascinating. And now a word of advice. Go away immediately. You see, this house must be a very unhappy place. Full of memories, grave and gay in every corner of it. Also...
You mean they may still be here?
Quien sabe, as the Spanish say.
I wonder. Anyway, I'll take your advice and thank you very much, Madame Arcadia.
Well, cheerio once again, and good hunting.
Ruth? Elvira? You there? Ruth? Elvira? I know darn well you're there.
Well, I'm going away. Somewhere that I don't think you're going to be able to follow me. Can you hear me, my darlings? Ruth, you once said in one of your more acid moods that I'd been hag-ridden all my life. How right you were. But now I'm free. Not only free of Mother and Elvira and Mrs. Winthrop Llewellyn, but also of you. And I'm taking this farewell opportunity of saying that I'm enjoying it immensely. Aha! Elvira, you were very silly to think I didn't know about Captain Bracegirdle and you. I did. But what you didn't know was that I was closely attached to Paula Westlake at the time. Goodbye, my darling. I'm sure we're bound to meet again sooner or later, one of these days. But until we do, I'm going to enjoy myself as I've never enjoyed myself before. You can break up the house as far as I'm concerned. I'm leaving it anyway. Think kindly of me. Send our good thoughts. Goodbye once again. Parting is such sweet sorrow.
Next week, see The Virginian in color at its regular time.
This is William Shatner. Shakespearean tragedy is the bait when the crew of the Enterprise is almost overcome by a tragedy of their own. Join me on Star Trek tomorrow night at 8:30, 7:30 Central Time on the full color network NBC.
Stay tuned now as Barbara Rush and Jack Lord star in a love-torn drama aboard a Caribbean freighter when Bob Hope presents the Chrysler Theater next on NBC. Vine speaking. This has been a Compass production. The Hallmark Hall of Fame has been brought to you with the best wishes of the fine stores that feature Hallmark cards. Beautiful story the world has ever known. The story of Christmas. Told with striking new drama and color for 1966 by Hallmark artists. The bold brush of a contemporary artist interprets the Three Kings in a dramatic new way. While quaint folk art tells the wondrous story on golden cards that also serve as ornaments. Cherubs swing out in dazzling tones of orange and magenta. Never has color been as bright, as bold as it is today. So Hallmark artists reflect the times by painting Christmas in sunny shades of yellow, orange, and hot, hot pink. Or the lush and dusty shades of jungle green and midnight blue. Even the nostalgia of Christmas is freshly interpreted by Hallmark artists. A trip home for a country Christmas. Pine trees in the snow revive old memories with new charm. And just look at old Saint Nick now. He never looked jollier, all decked out in red velvet and white lace. Or wearing high-button shoes. Yes, the most beautiful story the world has ever known. Freshly interpreted, beautifully told, and just the way you'd like to tell it. On Hallmark cards. Available any way you prefer. Personalized with your name, boxed, or for individual selection. Hallmark cards. When you care enough to send the very best. In a moment, we'll return for the second act of Blithe Spirit on the Hallmark Hall of Fame. a burst of design, and a splash of color. A burst of design, and a splash of color. That's how Hallmark designers turn ordinary notes into something special. Then add a pen designed to match. What a thoughtful gift. Just $1.25. Take ordinary playing cards. Hallmark adds a burst of design and a splash of color. High fashion and style come to the bridge table. Two decks with matching score pad, just $2.95. When Hallmark artists turn their talents to writing paper, the same thing happens. Unique Hallmark stationery that says so much about you before you write a word. Tied with ribbon and sealed with its crown of good taste. A useful gift priced from $1 to $4 a box. Often, Hallmark stylists add a flair for fun to create gifts like these new picture pets, the world's most appealing wild animals. They're giant cards, delightful plaques too, all ready to hang in a child's room. While other picture pets are on scrapbooks and puzzles. Here's another colorful gift idea. Hallmark Thoughtfulness Albums. There are pages to write down birthdays and other special events, and a packet of Hallmark cards for all occasions, all for just $3.95. What a charming way to teach youngsters thoughtfulness. And for perfect family gifts, there are new beautifully illustrated Hallmark books, The Miracle of Christmas and Christmas Treasures, featuring collections of famous Christmas art and writings. Yes, a flair for fun, a burst of design, a splash of color. Make Hallmark gifts something special. They're all at fine stores that feature Hallmark cards. P.S. And just for dropping in, the stores that feature Hallmark cards have a gift for you. The new 1967 Hallmark date book. In a moment, we'll return for the third act of Blithe Spirit on the Hallmark Hall of Fame. How can you make a $2 gift look like a million? Just wrap it in Hallmark gift wraps, the added touch that means so much. And the gift wrapping news this Christmas is here, here, and here. First, Hallmark stylists started a new color trend by introducing the cool, cool colors of Christmas 66. Fashion shades of misty green splashed with icy blue. Smart designer papers that please the touch as well as the eye with their sculptured three-dimensional effect. Or if you prefer, Hallmark stylists can change the mood with their new hot colors of Christmas 66. A striking blend of hot pink, orange, and scarlet. A deep Victorian red. Brilliant designs with a look of modern art available in rolls and packages. Or if you're wrapping lots of gifts, Hallmark makes it easy and economical too with popular Hallmark cutter boxes. See, you can wrap all these gifts with a paper that comes in just one Hallmark cutter box. The ribbon used this Christmas is Hallmark ribbon that has the look and feel of velvet, but costs far less. So easy to tie, it adds a new look of elegance to any gift. Or choose famous Hallmark Hall Sheen ribbon, the ribbon that sticks to itself when moistened. Another newsmaker this year, exclusive Hallmark pop-up trims. These enchanting trims that pop up into little three-dimensional scenes are really a little gift in themselves. Yes, with such a beautiful array of new Hallmark papers and ribbons and trims, Hallmark gift wraps are truly the added touch that means so much. In a moment, we'll bring you the names of tonight's cast. Mr. J.R. Poinsett of South Carolina wouldn't believe his eyes if he could see what's happened to the flower he brought to this country from Mexico back in 1828. Suddenly, it's new, brighter, gayer, with a smart new look for 1966, thanks to the imagination and artistry of a Hallmark designer who plants them on everything, from cups to coasters. Hallmark has a green thumb when it comes to entertaining, knows how to make an informal party blossom and bloom, and lets a busy hostess toss away the cleanup chores afterwards. Hallmark even dictates what the well-dressed snowman will wear this year. Top hat, muffler, red mittens, and cane, with a dashing touch of holly on plates, party favors, guest towels, and napkins. Fun for family meals throughout the holidays. For homemade gifts of cookies or fruit, Hallmark provides special, inexpensive, and decorative plates. Cover them with a clear wrap and add a Hallmark bow for a festive touch. Or let these jolly gentlemen give you a hand. Very versatile, that Mr. Claus. He comes flat, grows fatter by the second, serves as party favor, or takes to the air with the greatest of ease with 8 tiny reindeer in a Hallmark mobile. Pre-assembled, pre-strung, free-swinging. Hang it in a child's bedroom to make visions of sugar plums dance in his head. Hallmark designers take the familiar, add the magic of imagination, and create an original that tells an old, old story in a fascinating new way. Hallmark's new dimensional nativity, a perfect way to help a grandchild learn the story of the first Christmas when herald angels sang. An inspiration for Hallmark's beautiful Christmas angel. So look for Hallmark decorations and party aids. Hallmark plans a party, makes entertaining fun for everyone, including the hostess. Next on the Hallmark Hall of Fame, The Choosing of a President, 1860, Abe Lincoln in Illinois. Robert E. Sherwood's Pulitzer Prize-winning play stars the brilliant Jason Robards. The drama of a turbulent election campaign, the poignancy of a difficult marriage, provide a revealing portrait of a warm, gentle man who was catapulted into greatness. Don't miss Abe Lincoln in Illinois, Thursday, February 2nd, on the Hallmark Hall of Fame. Remember when fire engines really had horsepower? Maybe you don't, but Grandfather does. And this Hallmark calendar will bring back fascinating memories. A thoughtful, fun gift that will last all year, just $1.50. Remember the vamp and the flapper? Fashion today reminds you of those days, captured by Hallmark designers in this very smart, very gay Art Nouveau calendar, just $1.50. Hallmark artists this year have created an especially large and outstanding collection of calendars, featuring everything from behind-the-headline sports scenes with comic illustrations to a charming culinary almanac for the gourmet cook. Typical Hallmark touch, wine, cheese, and herb charts that suggest the perfect gourmet combinations for gifts or for yourself. See all the Hallmark calendars at fine stores that feature Hallmark cards.